welcome everyone to xEssentials. Tonight's topic is animatronics, and we've got Jerry Jewell of Skulltronics, who is going to give us an overview of what animatronics include and show us some of his awesome props. Jerry, you've got the floor.
Hello, everybody. We're going to start out our little Skulltronics with showing you a couple of projects that I've been working on, and then some of the older products. So what you're looking at, I think, is a new product called Fire Dog. It's not actually for sale. It's just something I created for our local parade. And he is going to drive over here. Oh, better back up. Turning radius isn't too great. And he's going to sing me a song. Okay, I think that's probably enough of that. You get the idea. Hold on. Scroll to the right a little bit. Hold on, we're teaching a beginner here. Stop now, yes. There we go. So he stopped. Want to drive him back in the shop? All right, let's go on in to the shop. This is a another similar setup. This is me on the front, because everybody says it looks like me. So his name is me. And there's some little green Grinch kind of looking toy soldier, and some guy who needs his hair trimmed on the back. All of them are in need of some serious costume work. And we don't have a name for her yet. There's going to be some snow on top with lighting. Right now, there is lighting around the inside, around the, let me turn it on. We do have these little projector guys on the corners to project in on the characters. And we do have, you can't see them in the daytime, but there are a lot of other lights. So we got a lot of work to do on this yet, but it drives around and all four characters sing songs, and obviously it's for parade. So more work to do, but it's getting there. Up here's the ball. We call this one the PVC ball because the frame is made out of PVC. There's an identical one at my house in the garage, 5 foot diameter. The one at the garage is stainless steel. I've posted videos of it before. It's a lot of fun. And then we have, this is called the Disability. It's a tree built on top of a electric wheelchair. And where's my other one? I can't see a thing. It's so dim. Oh, there it is. This is the Segway tree. So this is actually a costume you wear. It's 8 feet high and 5 feet in diameter. And you get on a Segway and you put this on your shoulders and drive around. It's quite lightweight. Both of these trees are exactly the same layout, about 2,000 pixels. Okay, moving along. I wanted to show you, before we get any further, some of what I do. This is a silicone mold. This happens to be a three-piece mold, and it makes this skeleton guy. This is just one that's not painted or decorated yet. So we put the three parts together. You want to do video? That's here to do video now. Clamp it all down and we pour liquid polyurethane plastic in, so two-part mix, and that makes this or hollow shape for the skulls. Makes them very lightweight, very easy to work with. This is one of our animatronic skulls and a peek inside. This is our SOC control board, handles 14 servos, and we'll be talking about this more in detail. And Gil Jones added support for this board into xLights, so we'll be talking about that later. And Gil did a very nice video on how to get it all going, and we'll touch on that briefly. So just to give you an idea, the jaw opens and closes. The jaw servo is hiding in here. There aren't any visible wires or anything coming out of it. The control rod's actually inside the skull. This is the nod servo, and it makes it obviously do this. We have a servo right here called the tilt servo, and it makes it tilt side to side. And then we have a nod, so that's the nod servo. And then we have a servo right here that makes it pan left and right. Now there have been other animatronic skulls on the market, but they all rely on some kind of a post system, and they suffer greatly from what's called precession. I'm gonna switch devices here. This is one of our older tilt swivels. One of the things that our products don't do is they don't have any interference from one servo to the other. So when you make it nod, it does not also do some other crazy motion. And just about any other design you see will, if you move a tilt or if you move a nod or if you move the pan, it will have an effect on the other servos, their position. And it makes animating extremely difficult when you have to deal with two or three servos for each single motion that you want to program. So let's move into my office, and we'll actually fire one of these guys up and show you what it looks like. I'm going to move back here a little bit. I'm going to turn off the lights. So this is what you're seeing now is a full standing skeleton. It can sit, it can stand, it can crouch. It does not need any kind of support. It's got these big aluminum plates on the bottom of the feet that you can set it anywhere in a room and people can walk around it. And you'll notice that we've got lights on it. Those are DMX lights. The software that we use for animating also supports lighting. And in this case, DMX lighting only. So let me get it fired up and we'll show you what it looks like.
We're getting feedback, Charlie.
I'm going to introduce myself.
You need to mute your mic. Are we okay now with the echo?
Yes. Yes.
Yes, let's try this again. I thought we were going to just figure it out. Let's do have an echo. See what it does.
Welcome. So glad you could join us. Allow me to introduce myself. I am the new state of the art, a Skulltronics talking skull. Wait just a moment, please. Lights. Do you know these colors are bad for my skin tone? Much more ghastly. Proper lighting can certainly set the right tone. Don't you agree?
I'm gonna stop.
You seem to have a good head on your shoulders. I trust you've noticed our actions.
Okay, we're gonna Okay, I'm sharing the screen now on Jerry Jewel. This is a software called VSA, and it's what we use for our animation. and it looks a lot like xLights in that you have different events. So my internet connection is unstable. Thank you. So these events are servo motions. And the length of the event is how long it takes that motion to happen. And if you double click on one of these events, you get the properties for that. Now, we happen to be on an event for the jaw. It tells us what kind of an event it is, start and stop times, and it's starting and stopping position. Now, the starting position is set by the previous event, so you can't edit that, but you can edit its stop position. And in our case, 500 happens to be closed. That's the jaw being closed. But you kind of have to know what your values mean. And you can move them around with a dial here, and you can capture those values. But I don't do that very much. You can also run up and down. It's a pretty easy program to learn because it doesn't do much. In the settings, you'll spend a lot of time in settings. Under tools, settings, and this is where you define what kind of servos you have. In this case, we have a jaw. It's a BOC servo. BOC meaning Board of Chucky, which was our first control board. Our newest control board called an SOC. The first one was Board of Chucky. The second one is Son of Chucky. For you horror fans, what port we're using, in this case we're using an Intec Pro interface, what DMX address it's at, its maximum value and its minimum value, and what default it has. So if you hit the backspace key while you're in the VSA window, it will take it every servo in the system to its default position, which is most of the time a good thing. You have your power channel. It's a special relay built into the BOC board that shuts the power off to the servos and turns the power on to the servos under program control. So at the very beginning, if you can see my cursor, it's as big as I can get it, there's a little event here in the power channel, and that sets the power on for all the servos. And at the end of the animation, we do another little event that turns the servos off. If you fail to turn the servos off at the end of your animation routine, the SOC and the BOC boards will turn off the servos after 1 minute of receiving no DMX signals. Is everybody hearing me okay? I'm getting no feedback here.
We're hearing you fine.
Yep.
Okay, good. The names of the different tracks here are very important for keeping track of, because you want these names to be the same in your xLights setup when you do your import. It makes everything very simple. Now, in my case, I have all of the standard Skeltronics names to match xLights, but I also happen to have DMX channels for my lights. Now, it doesn't make sense to do your lighting in VSA and then turn around and try to import that into DMX Skeltronics channels. So we would turn these off and recreate them directly in xLights. Okay, moving along. Also under tools, we have load audio file. And you have to tell VSA where your audio file is, or it simply won't find it. And when you load the file, when you import the effect into xLights, it will recognize the audio file. And as I recall, one time I loaded it, and the second time it didn't load, and I had to load it in the sequence settings. So that's something I'm not sure is working right. It might just be me.
I haven't done that import very often. I think I've done it four or five times. You also have the ability, there's several different variations of the VSA software. This is the cheapy hobby version. I think it's about $60 to $80. It's all you need unless you want to do fancy things with video, because it will also allow you to sync video, sound, and animatronics, as well as DMX lighting, all together. I wouldn't want to try that with xLights. I have no idea if that's even supported. Okay. Where do we want to go from here? Let's go. Let me get rid of any questions on VSA before I leave this screen. I can't hear anybody other than.
If you have a question, please unmute yourself and ask. There's nothing in chat.
I'm going to have to turn the volume up here because I can't hear. What did you just say?
I just said, if anyone has a question, feel free to unmute yourself.
Oh, okay. So VSA, like I said, it doesn't do a whole lot, but it's extremely easy to create animations. And before I leave VSA, one of the things that people ask me is, can I just put a soundtrack in and it'll automatically create the animation? No, but there is a feature under tools called wave motion analysis, and there's something similar in xLights. And in here, you tell it which particular track you want to follow the sound, and it's pretty typical with this kind of a thing. It just follows the loudest sounds. So you tell it what the maximum and minimum values are that you want to create. You have an error and a scale percentage. And it works really well if you have just a soundtrack that's voice only. When you start throwing music and drum beats in, obviously it wants to create a draw motion then for every drum beat, and that doesn't work out too well.
So somebody's asking in chat, what version of VSA is that?
This is version 5. And this is 5.001, and there is a more recent version of this out. One thing you're going to find from brookshiresoftware.com is they don't support their products worth a damn. So when you buy the software, don't expect support. I've been supporting a couple of thousand of their customers now for almost 10 years because they don't. It's kind of annoying, but what are you going to do? They don't do it. Okay, go away. Now, we're going to go not to xLights. We're going to go to this product called Helmsman Pro. And this is something like the xScheduler in that it allows you to sequence and control your animations, your audio, your video. It has a pocket remote control that lets you, it has four buttons on it that are programmable, and it has the ability to log into it with a web browser and change whatever's playing. So basically you just say plus, tell it whether you want a VSA audio or a relay, and we can say VSA. A routine, it loads it in, it's automatically enabled, and you can set the volume, and it's pretty cool. You can set a delay between them, and when you play it, it'll just run through and play them in order, and you can move them up and down and change their order. And then we have a thing called triggers. These would be the buttons, or the pins. Let me see if I can show you this in the camera that I'm on. There we go. This is called a gatekeeper I/O board. It plugs into your USB port on your PC and lets you use an RF remote. It also has 8 inputs and 8 outputs, for controlling relays or sensing triggers such as motion detectors. This is part Helmsman Pro software and the Gatekeeper are part of our Showmaster system. So most people who buy our animatronics also buy this because it makes it a lot easier to control. And you do not need the VSA software to play back pre-recorded routines with the Helmsman Pro software. Now, there's an add-on to this yet. There's a product called Live Action. I'm kind of looking at myself sideways here, which is weird. And Live Action, I moved myself. Hey, where did you go? There I am. Live Action allows you to put on a hat with free reflectors, use a camera monitor, your laptop, and control a Skulltronics, animatronic, anything that's actually controlled by a SOC or BOC board live. So as an actor turns their head and talks, the device itself will move in real time. It'll move very quickly, and everything's, there's no delay. It's very quick. You can see that in a YouTube video. Search for Skulltronics Live Action, and there's a short video of my daughter doing a demo of it. Very effective. Something that would be cool if xLights could add in, but that's a whole other issue. All right, let's move on to xLights. And everybody can see my screen okay?
Yes, we're fine.
Sharing?
Yeah,
you okay, are. Good. All right. So in xLights, you come in and create a, I can't remember this one, create a new DMX. So when you create a new DMX, it defaults to moving head, but you can change that to a Skulltronic skull. Once you do that, and all of these values change, and these are the default values for an off-the-shelf Skulltronic skull. Number of channels is usually set to 50, just to have enough. And then you start defining individual channels. This is the pan servo, is at DMX channel 13. This is the pan orientation, straight ahead is zero. The degrees of motion rotation, it can't really turn 540 degrees, but it can turn 180. The pan minimum is 250, and the maximum is 1250. These values are brought in from VSA. VSA takes the milliseconds, the actual pulse width modulated milliseconds, and cuts it in half. So 250 is actually 500 milliseconds, and 1250 is 2,500 milliseconds. So if you're used to working with servos, that will make more sense to you. Just double these values to get your milliseconds. Tilt channels at channel 19. Tilt orientation, that's its default tilt. That's a left or right tilt, like you were saying, no. Degrees of rotation, I'm not sure why we have that in here, because the limits here really are what defines the degrees of rotation, not this setting. Nod, same thing, jaw, same thing. And then as we scroll on down, we get into the eye LEDs. Well, here's the actual the eye servos, up, down, left, and right. And then we have the eye brightness, eye red, eye green, blue, and there is no white. Almost said snow white. Okay. Start channel, let's go back to this guy, is normally set at 9. Even though we have channels and I'm not sure why that's at 7. The jaw channels at the same address. That's just the way VSA is defined. I had nothing to do with that. So let's get rid of that. So once you've defined your skull, then you can do a new sequence. And Gil has covered this in his video. You pick musical sequence. You pick your music. Quick start. So here's the music. Here's the head. And then here's all of the different channels. This jaw and jaw fine is... That's all explained in Gil's video. I don't want to go through that again. And then once you have all that set up, then you can go to Import Effects, click on the VSA file that you need. And I haven't defined, I can tell it PID for all of these. And it will try to match up the names. And I have found. And let's just assume it's correct and say okay. And it pulls in all of the events out of the VSA routine. Any questions at this point? I know I'm covering a lot of stuff quickly.
So Jerry, there was a question, but I think you addressed it. The question was, since Gil is adding support, is it possible to just use xLights to control the servos and programs? Rather than using the VSA player. So,
yes, you can use xLights. I'll have to warn you though, creating animation in xLights is a pain. It's a pain in the ass. It is not user friendly for creating animation. And I'm not a real big supporter of Brookshire software just because they don't offer really any support at all. But it is the cheapest and best alternative for creating quick and dirty animation. And it's reasonably priced. They do sell a much more expensive version, but you don't really need it unless you're doing fancy stuff with video, and then you're not working with xLights anyway. You're working just with VSA. Okay. So if I were actually hooked up via DMX, to my laptop here, we could be running this same routine right now. But you really want to get everything polished in VSA before you bring it over. Now, let's talk about servos. Let me find if you're not using a Skulltronics animatronic and you're trying to create your own, there I am, you're going to have to buy servos. And servos come in different sizes, they come in different speeds and different torque. And when you buy them, they're priced by the torque. So the more power they have, the more expensive they will be. There's two basic kinds of servos. There's analog and there's digital. The digital ones are usually programmable. There's all kinds of features that can be programmed. And pretty much none of those features are necessary if you're using one of our control boards, because almost all of those features are programmable in the control board. So this particular servo, it's an old one. Probably cost me $12. This is a really old one. The newer servos that I put in the animatronics are typically $30 to $50. Some people want all digital. Some people don't like digital. The real big difference from a practical point of view is digital servos, when you remove the PWM control signal do not shut down. They keep holding the last position that they got. And that was a huge problem for us and caused me to have to redesign the VOC board for the SOC board, because when I was using digital servos in some of my larger projects, they wouldn't shut down. They just hold there and they'd eventually burn out. So we built in the VOC board, had the ability to turn off the PWM signal that controls the servo. And that was great for analog servos. They would just shut down. But with the digitals, they kept holding that last position. And so we had to redesign the board to actually turn off the ground so the servos no longer had power. And that cost me about 3 years of development and a couple thousand dollars in engineering time. Pain in the ass. My favorite phrase today, since I've been in 5 meetings in a row. So servos, when you're creating an animatronic, the first thing you got to do is figure out what is the load going to be. What is the, you know, people ask me, well, your animated skeletons, can they pick up a guitar? Like, hell no, they can't pick up a guitar. That would require, you know, not inch ounces of torque, but many pounds of torque. And servos aren't anywhere in that category. You just can't do it. Even the most expensive servos that are $1,200-$1,500 each can pick up 3 or 4 pounds if you're lucky. But you wouldn't want to push them doing that all day long. Servos have a range of motion. Let's go on to our next software package, which is our configuration program called the SOC configuration program. Here we go. Hopefully everybody can see that. Goodbye, xLights. This is where, if you're not using a standard off-the-shelf Skulltronics animatronic, you would want to come in and define your servos, what kind of servos they are, what direction they turn, whether they're high resolution or low resolution, what their addresses are in both DMX terms and in VSA terms. And this is going to screw you up more times than you will care about. VSA subtracts 1 from the DMX address. I have no idea why. Brookshire's aware of it. He's been aware of it for decades. And yet, VSA goes from 0 to 54, not from 0 to 55, and they subtract 1 address. So as an example, the first channel on the control board, hold on. I'm not as organized as I thought I was. Okay. On the control board, you can see there's rows of pins for the servos, and they're labeled A through O. So that's what these letters represent. So the servo plugged into the A channel is the jaw. And the type of servo that it is it has 180 degrees of travel. It's high resolution, which means it takes 2 DMX channels to give it 1024 resolution. Your choices here are high resolution 180 reverse, which makes the servo move in the other direction, high resolution 90 forward or reverse, and low resolution 180, or you can just go with raw milliseconds or raw milliseconds reverse. Everything we're doing here and everything in xLights that's set up so far is high resolution 180 or high resolution 180 reverse. So why would I want to pick reverse? Well, in the case of those 4 characters out there on the trike, I'm having an allergy attack, hang on. Some of the jaws, when they're wide open, they're at their lowest milliseconds, their lowest values. And when they're closed, they're at their highest. And that's backwards from how I like it. I like low values to be closed and high values to be high. and I like when it nods. When it nods down, I want that to be a low value. When it nods up, I want it to be a high value. So sometimes I have to, depending on the mechanics of what you're working, you may want to reverse it. If you buy a high-tech servo that is forward direction, and then you decide to switch to Futaba, then they're backwards. So you could take an animatronic that's got a high-tech, reconfigure the board to be a 180 reverse, and you don't have to change any of your programming. It's all done at the board level. So then here's your DMX address. You'll have to make this value the same in VSA. And because it's a high-resolution servo, it means it takes up both DMX address 8 and 9. And then xLights, that'll be 9 and 10, because it's real DMX is one higher. Then this is where you set your what's called limits of travel. And in this case, 500 is closed for the jaw, and 750 is fully open. Now, the servo is capable, I'm going to lose my mind here with my voice. The servo is capable of 180 degrees of motion. That's what it says right here. But if we were allow it to move 180 degrees, it would break something inside the skull because there's not physically enough room for it to move that far. So this is a safety device. This lets you set the limits of travel, not in VSA, although you will also set it in VSA. This makes you set it at the board level. So if you give that animatronic to somebody else to program, they can't break it by making values that are too high or too low. The board will force the servo to stay within these limits. So let's say you set this, you put your servo horn on, you know, your actual connector from the jaw to the servo, and in that 500, it's not closing all the way, or it's closing too far, and it's making the jaw chatter when it talks. Then you can use the trim factor to either open or close the jaw further. And when you get that set so that the jaw is exactly where you want it, you can then go down to here to transfer settings, transfer those settings to your board, and I don't want to do that, so I'm going to unhook the skull that's attached. You can transfer the settings. It's a one-way transfer. The software does not know if the board's actually getting it or not. Pardon me. If the settings are there, and then you can go and test the settings. So we have jaw checked. We're going to go over to this servo slider, and we can slide it up and down in real time and watch the jaw move. And if it moves to our satisfaction, then we can say commit the settings, and it will send a signal to the board to save the settings into its EEPROMs. Whichever servo you have checked that is at the topmost is the one that the servo slider will move. So we'll now be doing the nod, and as I move that, the nod will move up and down, and so on. If I have several of them selected, only the one in green will respond to the servo. If I want to test multiple servos at the same time, I turn on the ones I want to test. I come down here to system test. Movement type, random or sequential. I usually like random, but you want to see them one at a time, and hit start. And then it will start going through and testing all the servos. And you can sit and watch. And more than just sitting and watching, you can sit and listen. Because if you have limits that are too far, you can hear things inside your animatronic device banging around. That's when you hit the stop button and figure out what limits in here are wrong. Keep your servos from making parts inside your animatronic clash against each other. Moving on to eyes. There are three LED channels on the SoC board. two of them are output to the eyes, and they have and they respond to the same DMX address. They have a what we call a dim strobe channel, where you set both dimming and strobing in the same channel. Everything below 128 is your strobe rate. Everything above that is your dimming level. So you have 128 dimming levels and 128 strobing levels. Typically, if you're strobing, you're at full brightness, so it doesn't really matter. I don't myself use the strobing function. I usually leave this at 255 in the VSA program, and I never do anything other than just set this to its maximum value. If I want to dim anything, I do it in the red, green, blue settings. But this particular is just for testing. In VSA, you can set your values to what you want them to actually display. Does that make sense? Matt, did that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, before we leave this program, LEDs in the eyes and your third LED, your auxiliary LED, they don't come out of the box white when they're set to white. When you turn all these channels up to 255, you look at them and you go, that's too blue, too red. If you want a pure white, we have a setting here where you can adjust what you think pure white is, whether you want a warm white or a blue white or whatever. The color temperature is set in these three right here. Again, when you transfer that to the board knows when you say all these values at full value, or all these values equal, I should say, that you'll get a white. And it will be white across the full range of these if these are all equal. Hope that makes sense. Let's see. We have one more thing here. We have the power channel. The power channel is built into the board to be one address less than your starting DMX address, which is up here. So when I run the power channel up and down, this is backwards from my logic, but when it's at its highest value, the power is off. And when it's at its lower value, the power is on. So this turns on power on and off to the servos. You can, and it has a default timeout of 100 milliseconds, 1 second, I mean 1 minute. And you can change the default timeout. If you don't like it, you can get rid of it. And you can set the trigger level of it. And we never do this. We just go zero is on, 255 is off. Makes it very simple. In VSA, that the jaw servo is set up, not as a servo, I shouldn't say servo, the jaw relay is set up as a relay, DMX relay, not as a servo. It takes one DMX channel, not two, but it doesn't need 1,024 steps. Probably losing everybody at this point. I'm hearing snoring. I think we're pretty well done with this program. It has a disconnect and a connect. So if you want to interactively go between configuring here and programming in VSA, before you can switch back to VSA and run animation, you have to disconnect this because it keeps the port open. And VSA will give you an error. So you want to disconnect, and we'll hide that now. And we will hide Helmsman. There's lots we could cover here, but there's more later on. All right, so Helmsman is gone. And let's go back to xLights. Yes, I have three monitors. Let me pause for questions here because I'm about to move into more details on the VOC board or the SOC board if anybody's interested in it.
So I think there's only one question in chat, and I think you covered it, which was, don't you have to move the power slider up from zero? I think you were showing on the slider.
Okay. Let me show in VSA, in the settings, the jaw is, I'm sorry, the power is a DMX relay, not a VOC servo. Same output though, on Intech Pro in this case. Its address is one below whatever your base address is. If you have, where am I? If you have multiple Skeltronics animatronics or multiple devices running off of SOC boards, and they each have their own SOC board, and you set them all to a base address of 8, that's perfectly okay, because they will then share the DMX address for the power. So you only need one power on-off command for all of your animatronics. But what you would do is you would change the DMX addresses of the individual servos so that they don't overlap. Make sense? So you keep the same base address on every single SOC board, but change the jaw addresses so they all get their own individual commands. And we've got, now that I'm here, I'm sorry, I see one more thing. There's this thing at the bottom here called Auto P. It's MNOP, and it allows you to use an auto talk board if you're not familiar with that. An auto talk board takes microphone input and converts it to servo output. And it's used for using a microphone to control a jaw in a live interaction with a crowd. And when you are using the Track Skull software, which is part of the live action system, and you click on connect in that software, it will send the board a command to say, no longer take your input from the VSA routine for the jaw, take your input from the microphone. And it happens automatically and seamlessly, and it's part of the VOC board. So there's a lot of things on the VOC SOC boards that are very unique. That one is definitely unique. You will not find that on any other board. And the ability to set the same base address for all the boards and just change the offsets.
And so there's two questions in chat. First is, are today's servos as noisy as ones in the past?
That has to do with the type of servos. There are plastic geared servos and metal geared servos. Plastic geared servos are quieter. They're not as durable as far as handling abuse. But I say that, and then I've got customers who have told me that they've got their skulls running 24 hours a day at their window display in their store, and they've been running for 3 years and they've never replaced the servo. And other people who've got metal geared servos that have broken a gear, you know, the third week that they've had it. So the field experience doesn't necessarily reflect what the logical, you know, conclusion would be if you were just thinking, oh, you got titanium gears versus plastic gears.
Right.
The metal gears are noisier. Typically, these animatronics are being used in environments where the sound is turned up, and even from a couple of feet away, with the sound cranked up, you will not hear them. But when you're sitting at your desk and that thing is right next to you and the sound is turned down, you will hear them, whether they're plastic or metal. But in a real environment for Halloween or Christmas where they're outdoors entertaining crowds, nobody's going to say they heard the gears and the servos. Not going to happen.
Okay. The next question is, can you use this software with Lynx Motion SSC32?
What software?
I guess whatever you're demoing.
VSA. Let's talk about VSA. VSA, when you go to your
settings. Their software.
the Skulltronics. No, because it only supports the Intac outputs, which really has nothing to do with us. It has to do with the outputs that you're using. But when you are in your settings for VSA and you click on type of servo, you have various kinds. Here's your SV203 serials, mini SC relays. There's lots of different kinds of output that VSA supports if you're running in VSA. But the software, our configuration software, requires an Intac or an Intac compatible USB to DMX adapter, will not work with the serial interfaces. Did I get that explained clearly enough? And I don't think that xLights in the setup, I don't think there's anything in here that's going to accept anything other than Intac compatibility. But that you're going to have to check with Gil on. I just don't think it's there.
Okay, thanks.
Now, I have taken these xLights sequence and put it into a Raspberry Pi and played it out through the Raspberry Pi cap, hooked to a Raspberry Pi, through the DMX output on the Raspberry Pi, and it works fine. But again, that doesn't answer any question about serial output. I have no idea. I don't use serial outputs on anything that I do. I know somebody out there is going to say, well, DMX is a serial protocol. Yes, it is, but it's not straight serial output. Any other questions? I know I'm going through a lot of stuff here.
No, just we've got a couple more minutes.
Okay, let me go back to servos. Get this guy. Can we switch over to my feed rather than the shared? Is that happening? We talked earlier about range of motion on servos. We can set them in the VOC board to be 90 or 180, and then you can further refine the settings in the VOC with your minimum and maximum settings. Typically, you don't. If you want really fast motion from your servo, very, very responsive, like on our jaw, we want our jaws to be really quick. We don't want them missing any syllables in a fast spoken word. We would set the range of motion in the mechanical hookup of the servo to the jaw to be as short as possible. And I believe in our Skulltronics skull jaws, it's about 15 degrees of motion out of a 180. And that makes the servo move very, very quickly. And pretty much the same thing with the tilt and the nod. But the pan, which goes a full 180 degrees of motion, there isn't any way to speed that up. You're limited on the speed of the pan to the speed of the servos. And I said earlier that you can buy servos at different speeds and different torque. Higher torque servos tend to be slower speed and vice versa. So you need to know when you're creating your own animatronic device, what your loads are, how much torque you need, and how much speed you need. And you can make an object so fast and so powerful that you can hurt people with it. So trust me, I've done it. I've gotten my fingers caught in between parts of our tilt swivel mechanism using digital servos that are pulling 600-800 ounce inches of torque, and they will take the end of your finger off. But the stuff that we ship standard isn't that kind of nonsense. Are we about out of time?
Yeah.
I hope I help somebody.
So there is a question that says, how weather sensitive are the servos?
The servos are pretty well sealed. And if you have the shafts pointing downwards, you're not going to have any problem at all. There are waterproof servos from Hi-Tech. We've used our skulls outside in the rain a lot, but we've got a skull cap that overlaps the skull and keeps the rain out of the skull cap. So we have done 3 and 4 hour shows outdoors in pouring rain and not had any issues. But that's because they're inside of a skull that doesn't let water in. Your bigger problem will be heat, not moisture. Heat is bad for the plastic and is bad for the electronics. You take one of our skulls or pretty much any plastic device, stick it in an attic in your garage in Phoenix, Arizona, and in the summertime you're going to come back, and in the fall you're going to come back into your garage and find you've got a blob of plastic laying there.
Well, thank you very much. I think we've all learned quite a bit, and am very impressed with everything that you've developed and created.
The xLights project exists because of people like you. Help continue the project by making a donation today at xlights.org/donate.